Judge Schroeder's demeanor is obviously another very big topic of discussion to this day. As the longest serving circuit court judge in Wisconsin, how much power and influence did he have in this case? Let's start with you, Troy.
Right. It is interesting to see the coverage of Judge Schroeder, because to people who've been in this area, who've been covering him, and I've been in his courtroom many times covering different things, you almost get desensitized to some of the jeopardy, the almost chumminess with the jury, right? That has been commonplace with Judge Schroeder. In my kind of investigation, as I was launching this podcast, one of the things that I was constantly told was wait for the judge to blow up, right? As far as in anger, to express himself, to emote, right? That is one of his commonplaces. And we saw that several times throughout the trial. I think a lot of the times it could be perceived as very harsh, very mean-spirited. Later on in the trial, he did say that, hey, you know, these are very competent attorneys. They've all practiced in front of me. And so, you know, basically I don't have any ill will against the attorneys, but it didn't seem like that in the heat of the moment during some of the ebbs and flows of this trial. But Judge Schroeder, as you said, he's the longest serving judge in that position, but he's also run unopposed, right, for the last several cycles, right? And Kenosha is a community where if you don't know somebody, you know somebody that knows that somebody, right? And that's the same way with Judge Schroeder. There's a lot of people who grew up with him, who went to school with him, right, who knew this kind of behavior and were almost desensitized to it because he's been there for so long.
We've got that sort of, you know, that local flavor and sense of what Kenosha is like, what Judge Schroeder is like, and how that plays out on a, you know, on a micro level. But I'm curious to hear from you, Insha. You know, how much power do judges have in courtrooms and in how cases flow, or how those narratives are? We saw a lot of different instances of things that the prosecution was not allowed to say or could not do. You know, can you break down whether or not that is a reflection of how much power judges hold, or really, like, you know, do they hold the keys in a sense?
Judges run their courtrooms like little fiefdoms. It was almost amusing and somewhat surprising to me how many of my friends reached out watching this trial to say, are judges actually like that? Is he doing this for the camera? And watching Judge Schroeder, I thought, actually, he's probably like this and more when the cameras aren't there in the courtroom on him. Because judges get to rule their courtrooms, make decisions, and they're basically unassailable. I mean, they literally sit higher than everybody. People call them Your Honor. They are given unchecked power, and the only way their power is ever checked or reversed is if the case gets appealed and an appellate court makes a different decision, which happens in a tiny, tiny fraction of cases. So judges have a tremendous amount of power, and the way that we saw Judge Schroeder wield his power in the courtroom by denying prosecution motions, by shutting down testimony, by reprimanding the attorneys, by making jokes, sometimes off-color jokes that made many of us watching cringe. That is stuff that happens in American courtrooms across this country day in and day out. It's par for the course. We're just surprised by it because we are finally shining a light and getting a chance to watch a trial in real life, in real time.